Well, how I got started in all of this was with my great grandmother. And my great grandmother was my spiritual partner. And the rest of the family really didn't understand at all. But I would stay with her. And when I was 17, I was getting ready to graduate from high school in Newport Beach, California. And I was afraid, like, oh God, I'm going to go out in the world. What am I going to do? What's going to happen? And about that time, I was going to all of these standard brand churches trying to find God. And my folks were great because they didn't care. They weren't religious, and it didn't matter if we went and explored and did whatever we did. So anyway, this one day I'm sitting in the Presbyterian church, and I had tried to listen to the minister. Now everybody left finally, and I'm there by myself, and I'm going, I don't feel God here, whatever that is. So that night I went home, and I always used to say the Lord's Prayer for whatever reason every night. And this one night, and it was in the dark, I was in bed, and I talked to God, and I said, God, if you really exist, you got to find me, because I've been looking for you and I can't find you. So please find me. About 2 weeks later, how hindsight's always 20/20. So when you look back, you could see the answer to your prayer, or you could see when you focused on something, had an intention, and how one step led to the other. So anyway, 2 weeks later, I go to spend the summer in Big Pine, California, which is on the eastern side of the Sierra Nevada mountains, with my great grandmother. So this woman, Violet Bertram, who had been trained by Ernest Holmes, and he was the metaphysical teacher of religious science, science of mind, and that was what he was doing. Well, she was trained as a practitioner and a teacher. So she would come in the morning, and my great grandmother would, and I would be sitting at the kitchen table, and Violet would be there, and we start asking our questions. Because the standard brand just really didn't work for me, because I couldn't understand it. I didn't know, and it didn't relate to me. So when she started teaching these metaphysical teachings, and they were like the metaphysical teachings of Jesus and such. But they were open too. It wasn't like a closed mind that this is the only way. It was that you would find truth wherever you could find truth. So anyway, as she's teaching all this, so I have 3 months in the summer between graduating from high school and entering college, where I was instructed in metaphysical teachings. And this one, my grandma had these little cottages where she rented those out, and there was this old guy, and I remember his name was Ed Fitting, and he was in the intensive care, and they thought he was going to pass away. So I said to Violet, I said, can we pray for him and it will matter or will happen? She said, oh yeah. So we prayed for him. She did it. I felt something that I had never felt before in my entire life. I was in that spiritual zone somehow. And next day he was well. And then he came back and he came home. And I went, wow. So then when I went away, my grandma's, and went back to Newport and went to Orange Coast College as a freshman at junior college, then I thought, I'm going to field test these principles. And so I went to the dean's office, and they had these brochures of the activities for the year, and I decided I want to be homecoming queen. Now, I had changed from graduating as a senior to then starting school. I lost 20 pounds, became a blonde. And my great-grandmother bought me a 1957 pink Pontiac convertible. And I had fingernail polish that just matched the car so I could fix all the spots. So here I am going to college with the, you know, pink convertible. And so I asked the dean, I said, and I was actually kind of shy. I said, well, how do I become homecoming queen? He said, well, you have to be nominated. Well, I was too embarrassed to ask anybody because they'd reject me probably. So I said, well, can I nominate myself? And he said, you know, there's no rule against it. So I nominated myself to be homecoming queen. And I got my girlfriends helped me. We made posters. I met every kid in that school, every person. And I do like people. So that's my nature. So I was into that. And I won by more points than anybody had ever won. And then I thought, well, why don't I become freshman class president? Which I didn't know anything about Robert's Rules of Order, because I was never, I'm more of a right brain person. That's why I've always been that way. Kind of an entrepreneur, right brain person. So anyway, I won that. And then I got married. And I never knew what misery was like until I got married. Because I had a wonderful childhood. I had a great life. I was, you know, my parents, we didn't have anything or much, but, you know, we'd sing and, you know, I had a fun life. I could do what I wanted and explore. So anyway, now I'm miserable because my husband is so critical and judgmental and alcoholic, womanizer, well, all the things, whatever. But I'm so grateful because it got me to go to church. And I think it's the right use of pain. So I went to church and I started studying the metaphysical teachings of Jesus. And I loved it because I could apply it, at least how we understood it. And so it was religious science, very much like unity is metaphysical. So as I did that, I studied more and things started happening. I started singing. Because I'm a singer and I did that. And I was my girl's Sunday school teacher. And as it went on and on, then I wanted to become a practitioner. And that was, I realized I wanted to help people because that's my nature. And so I did that. And then after I was a practitioner, I thought, well, yeah, I want to be. And I didn't know what my life's purpose was. And what I did was this. I got this little book I had found that was by Dingley May. And actually, he built the metaphysical place that's up in Joshua Tree, where they have the Institute of Mental Physics. And that sanctuary was built by Frank Lloyd Wright's son. But anyway, that was Dingley May. And I didn't know it at the time. And he told how to visualize to get what you wanted. So I wrote down everything that I wanted. I wanted for my life's work. I wanted to serve God. I wanted to use my talents and abilities. I wanted my time to be my own. I wrote a whole list of everything I wanted, but I didn't even know my talents and abilities. But I just trusted. And I would visualize myself telling my mother about my great job that I didn't have. And then when I would tell her, because I was going through also a divorce, and she'd say, well, do you have a job yet? I said, no, Mom, I'm visualizing. She said, you're what? You know, get real, Terry. Get a job. You have these little girls to support. And I went, well, I just can't tell her because I'm going to stay doing what I'm doing because I'm not going to get a job. I want life's work. Yeah. So I kept on visualizing. Now, another thing I started to visualize was my mailbox being full of letters with checks made out to me. Of course, I wasn't getting any letters and there were no checks made out to me. And the money that I was living off was what my great grandmother had left me after my husband had spent most of it on wine, women, and song or whatever. But I got some left that was helping me take care of me and the girls and all that stuff. So anyway, I started visualizing. And I would get the feeling of it, that I would go to the mailbox, open it up, and it would be full of letters with checks made out to me. And there were never any letters. I'd go out there, it was never going, but I'd keep it up. And then I realized, you know what? The mailbox is too small. That's the problem. So I would visualize the mail truck coming with these big gray bags loaded with letters with checks made out to me. Well, soon after that, you know, you forget about it, but it's already been done. You know, it's like I didn't even think about how's it going to happen, the right job or anything. Well, anyhow, one day, because it's all mystic, it's all how it works. I call it divine magic is how it really works. It's naturally, it's how it is. So anyway, my minister one day asked me if I would do a talk at church on Wednesday for these old ladies, a healing service. And I said, well, I don't know how to give a talk. He said, no, you'll be fine. You know, because he had something else to do. So I said, well, okay. So how I wrote my talk is I didn't know how to write a talk. So I was reading these books, like The Power of Your Subconscious Mind and all this. And I took scissors and I cut out all the paragraphs I liked and I taped them on this yellow lined paper and I read it word for word. Anyway, when I was done, you could feel the presence of the Holy Spirit, the Christ consciousness that was so heavy, you could almost cut it with a knife. I never felt anything like, and nobody even applauded when I finished. Nobody could move. It was like, boom. And fortunately, I invited my friend Joanne. She was my best friend, to come and hear me. And then everybody started applauding and all that. And I was like in another space. It was transcendental. And so I went over to Joanne and she said, "Terry, you're a speaker. You're a minister." And I went, "I am." And I went, "I am." In that moment. And then I said, "Well, what do you think?" She said, call Carl at the YMCA and go ask him if you can teach a class." So I did, and I was terrified because I didn't know how to teach a class, you know. If I even know now, I've written, you know, 6 books and more, but if I would have paid attention in English class, it would have been, I'd known I was an author. But I never even paid attention because I was busy talking in class because I was working on my career and joking, because I would be bored. So I played dumb blonde. That was really good. Always worked really good. It was fun. And so anyway, I did that and I started teaching these classes for women. And then pretty soon it was classes for men. But anyway, about all the money coming to the mailbox, 13 years later, $6.5 million that year came to the ministry, to Terry Cole-Whittaker, with mail trucks in big gray bags. And the difference, why did it take 13 years? That's the time it took for me to get to the level of my own ability by working on it and everything coming at the right place and at the right time. And that to me was an amazing experience. So that's that. And then I did the, I then got the job. So then I went to seminary. And the seminary, you know, was teaching, you know, the Bible, and it was teaching a lot of metaphysical teaching, science, psychology, all of these sort of things. But at that time, there weren't many women ministers. And so the teachers would talk about men. "We need some good men out there in the field, you know. And there was this one guy that was there that had a PhD, and they were falling all over themselves because this guy had a PhD, but his talks were so boring because all he did is quote. He had no feeling, no charisma, nothing, but this is how they thought was what it was supposed to be. But all the time I thought, you know, God knows I have a female body, and God knows that this is what I'm going to do, and I know what I'm going to do, and it really doesn't matter where they think I'm going to do it or not. So anyway, so then I graduated, and then when I graduated, I had to serve 2 years as an assistant minister, and this was in La Crescenta at the Church of Religious Science, where I have been doing all my basic teaching. I've been Sunday school teacher, you know, on the board of trustees, and done all of that sort of thing. And so anyway, the minister, and this was, I was being an assistant, and this was a Saturday before Easter Sunday, and I think it was probably 1975. And I was going to take a nap, and the thought that came to my mind is, Reverend Guy is in intensive care in the hospital, and you'll have to do the talk tomorrow, Easter Sunday. And I thought, that's a terrible thought for me to have. I don't want that. That's not what I want. As I laid down on the bed and I put my head on the pillow, the phone rang. And it was the board president saying, "Reverend Guy is in intensive care, and they don't know whether he will live or not. You have to do the talk tomorrow, Easter Sunday." Now, I got so nervous, I got the hives, and I showed up at the emergency room in the same hospital where he was in intensive care, hanging on to whether he'd pass or not. And I was so nervous. So anyway, I went and I did my talk, and it was fabulous. And I was there for about 6 months. Now, when he came back, I was attracting more people than he did. So pretty soon, that wasn't good for him. So he called me to the office, and he'd found some trumped up charges, like this one old lady I was counseling said, you know, my husband's drunk and his face falls in his plate every night at dinner. Should I have an affair? I said, that's not my business. You can do whatever you want. I'm not telling you what to do. So he trumped it up saying, I told this old lady to have an affair. And, you know, he had to find something. Well, anyway, so he calls me into this meeting. And he's got the board members there. I don't know what it's about. And I sit down in my chair and he's saying, well, we're going to have to fire you. And the reason being, of course, I wasn't making any money anyway, but you know, whatever for that one. But he said, we're going to have to fire you because if you did this and that and this and that. And I said, well, at least I'm not having an affair with two women in the church at the same time. He went, ah! He took the tape recorder out, the cassette out, pulled out the tape of the whole thing, and he said, and I said, no, he said, let's make a deal. I said, you got it. He said, if you just stay away from everything, do Sunday school, don't cause me any trouble, then I'll, because I was going to be ordained and after serving 2 years, and he was going to get rid of me before my ordination, and it would have been over. So anyway, I did that. I got ordained, and then I started doing assistant minister just on a Wednesday night in Whittier. And then I knew it was time to get a church, and what I really didn't want is to be in an office. I'm not an office kind of person, but I knew I had to be in an office and do certain things if I was going to fulfill my life plan and to do what I needed to do. So anyway, this one, La Jolla, had invited me, different people had invited me, but it never felt right because I decided this time I wasn't going to make it up. I was going to wait for God, my inner guidance, however it is, to tell me what to do. So anyway, this minister, they wanted me to speak in La Jolla, and they had a little church of about 25 people, maybe 50 ministers, and it met at this women's club in La Jolla. So anyway, I went down there, and I was giving the talk, and it was fine. It was no big deal. But anyway, I came home, and I was in the kitchen, and my friend Jean Graves, who is a minister in San Diego, called me and said, well, are you interested in being the minister at that church? And I said, well, you know, no, I don't feel it. I'm waiting for God to tell me. I hang up the phone. I turn around. There is no one in my house. Nobody's there. The voice from the sky in loud and clear says to me, that's where you're going. And I went boom like this. I had God bumps, chills, knowing I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt I was going there. And it took them. So anyway, I then called Jean back and said, yes, let him know I want a candidate. I'm actually serious about it. So I went down there to do the talk, and now they knew I was going to be a candidate for this. So you got these old people with their arms crossed, yoke, and I'm a girl, you know. So they're, and like 36 years old, you know, and cute and everything. So they got their arms crossed, and they're looking at me, and I'm trying to do my talk. And then I stopped, and I said, you know what? I'm trying to do a good talk here. And you're checking me out, but I'm checking you out, and you don't look very good at this time. Why don't you all uncross your arms? Let's forget about me being a candidate at all. Let's just have a good talk. You know, so we did that. So anyway, I went home, and it took them 4 months to make up their mind. And there was a few times I wanted to call and say, take this job and shove it, because I can't take it, because... But then they called, and I went down there, and my very first Sunday, 250 people showed up, because when things are right, things happen. And then as I did that, within 6 months or 5 months, there were 750 people coming to church. And now the church financially had been in the red, and now it was in the black. They were making tons of money. And so now I thought it'd be time, because I was working for $1,000 a month. It would be like time now. They're going to give me a raise. They're so happy with me. And as I go in there, the board president says, what makes you think you need to have a raise? Why do you deserve that? And I went, whoa, these people aren't practicing these teachings at all. And so I had to start standing up for myself. And I was always really weak in those areas. I would be really nervous about standing up for myself and doing that sort of thing. So then anyway, I got the raise. Well, not too long after that, now I'm having like 1,800 people on three services come. No, it wasn't that quite, almost, maybe 1,000, I guess, because of a small place we had to move. So the board president, who was a lawyer at this time, calls me to his office. And now everything's working good. And I had to get away from everybody I knew because I was easily swayed by other people. That's why when I went, I had a mission and I had to stay on it because I knew what I had to do. So anyway, he calls me to the office and he said, "We already have a committee together to find a new minister and replace you." I stood up. Another day, I had to get all my courage. I said, "Carl, you're going to be a board president for another 5 minutes. I'm going to be a minister for the rest of my life. If you fire me, I will take my congregation down the street." And he quit. Because it was the truth. They had nothing. But they all of a sudden had to lord it over everybody. And I was being a woman. They had to blah, 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 blah. So anyway, they left. So then that next year, then he moved up to new places. Then I decided it was time to go on television. I had been visualizing myself as a television minister for many years, but I never told anybody because you can't tell. I kept quiet about it, kept it inside, and I even had tried a couple of times to do some stuff with like KHJ, my own show and all that kind of stuff, but it really wasn't time. So anyway, I went and signed the papers for a 13-week contract at $5,000 a week, and I never got board permission. I wasn't going to ask them because they wouldn't let me do it, and I did it. So anyway, I hired Robert Schuller's consultant, and he came and taught me, and he'd been Oral Roberts' consultant and everybody. He taught me how to do TV ministry and what you need to do and how you need to make it work. So Bill Underwood, he was terrific. And he was a fundamentalist, but he liked me better than everybody. He couldn't figure out how, because I wasn't a fundamentalist, how I had all this energy, charisma, spirit, you know, all of this stuff. It never could dawn on him, but he did a good job. So anyway, I did that. And the first week we went on television, 13 letters came that week. And it was like cool that 13 letters came, but I thought, why didn't more letters come that day that people liked it or send money so we could do it? And I realized I never had even told my mother I was going to be on television, let alone inform anybody else, because I was too embarrassed to think I was on an ego trip. That I just had to be on TV and they'd criticize. Well, they criticize you anyway. That's the way it goes. That's what I wrote. "What you think of me is none of my business." You see? So anyway, I then got busy. You got to let people know. You know, you have to overcome that and communicate. So anyway, we just kept working at it. And over time, it grew and it was extremely popular and all of that. And then also, you know, I had been married a few times, you know, and that was just the way it was. And then I had this one, the husband, who, I remember when I announced the divorce, there were 800 people in my class that I was teaching. And when I announced that I was divorcing this Leonard, they all stood up and cheered. I went, whoa, I thought they were going to say, "Oh boy, you're a real idiot," you know, but hey, they were cool because I always just shared openly with what I was doing and my process of the thing. And people felt good about that because we're human beings. We go through what we make, I don't even call it mistakes. I call it my research. Nobody's ever made a mistake. It's our research because we sometimes have to try something to find it doesn't work or it does work. And if we learn from it, it's always valuable and it's always good. So everybody was very supportive. And then shortly after that time, I began to really look and say, you know, I've attained everything that the world says, when you attain this, you're happy. Fame, you know, fortune, everything. Respect, you don't really, you know, people don't really, you think people like you when you're there, but a lot of people have just envy. So it's a, you know, I had some guy one time come to the church service from the balcony and said he, and at the, after the service, say he came there to kill me that day. And I said, oh, thank you for sharing. I had no idea. And as the guards were coming to get him, he said, yes, my girlfriend was coming here and she split from me and I thought it was your fault. But after listening to you today, I realize what I've done. I went, whoa, that was cool. And so anyway, I started looking at, you know, I'm really not happy. And right around that time, I got a new boyfriend, and his name was Ruben. And Ruben had been in India. He was a lot younger. He's a real free spirit, just a terrific person in the sense of, and introducing me to India, introducing me to maybe that mystical way. And we started having fun. So what we did was, he had lived in a kibbutz for a while, and so I decided, we talked about go to Israel and do four TV shows. So I hired a crew in Israel, and we did four TV shows in different places around Israel. And I also felt like I was going back to different things in my history as a living entity, being in this 3D world, and kind of things that I had maybe been involved in religious-wise. And I just loved Jerusalem and the old city of Jerusalem, and did that, and that was wonderful. I got a taste of that, and then said, let's go to India. So then I got a TV crew, and I wanted to go to India to show people. And actually, when I was in Israel, and I still have some of those DVDs, we put them on DVD eventually, I interviewed Teddy Kollek, who was the most famous mayor of Jerusalem. And I asked him one question, what do you do for happiness? He said, happiness? I have no happiness. I went, ooh, that's a pretty unhappy dude right there. But that's his choice, you know? And so anyway, and I just loved the old city and going to all these places. And what I noticed there, that people, because it was so great to see all the people in their different costumes, of their different Christian beliefs or Jewish beliefs or Muslim beliefs, going into the Temple Mount and going into all these places. And I had had the first past life experience I had remembered was actually watching, it was taking this person called Jesus or somebody else, because the way I saw him was more strawberry colored hair, more blue eyes, more Irish looking. Compassionate, not the pictures they show you of that guy, because that wasn't him anyway. That was some other guy, some Italian guy that his, you know, that in the Roman Empire. Yeah, that was his picture. And that's probably the one people see when they say go to the light. They have the same photo. Because don't go to the light in the tunnel, that's for sure. You know, I know that one. And so anyway, I was the guard that took this person, Jesus, up to Pontius Pilate, or go up there. And by looking in his eyes and the love and the experience, I stopped being a Roman soldier. And then I remember standing and watching, carrying the cross and crying and feeling so like a loser that I did nothing to help. And that lifetime, I just died in the street, run over by a chariot or something like that, you know. But that was very touching for me. Then we went to India, and then in India I interviewed different people there and went to all these different holy sites. And I had also taken a group of 85 people then to see Sai Baba. Then going to India, I got a real taste for the place. And I had I went to also Nepal first. And then I loved it. It was like the air was different. There was a feel that was something there. And then we actually went to this Buddhist temple and kind of hid, because I went with Ruben and then this friend Dennis Adams, who is a healer, lives up here at Mount Shasta, and kind of really trippy guy. So anyway, we hid kind of where they couldn't see us, and the monks were all doing Om Mani Padme Om, and they had their dorjis, and they're doing all their prayers. And then they got to the point where, in the Buddhist thing, they use the drums and they use the horns to then take the prayers and move it up through the dimensions. So that's kind of what they do. Well, all that love that they had hit me right here. I got the whole hit. It was like, boom, of the incredible love and feelings that I got. And I was like, whoa, this is powerful. There are things that I hadn't experienced before. And I also noticed that people could hang out at temples, and that people who were poor were happy and loving. And I realized that here, even in America, people even in the welfare office are angry and pissed off and, you know, where's my check? And here, people, that the simplest people, their children would be with them, work in the store. They would play. They play kick the can, the kids would. And just simple thing, no big toys, no big things, smiling, laughing. And I thought that really changed my values when I came back. And I have to tell you this. I don't tell many people this, but I'm telling you this, and you can put it out, it's fine. When we were in Israel, Reuben took me to Caesarea. At the beach on Yom Kippur. And you weren't supposed to be out in Yom Kippur. You get stoned, you know. Even if we held hands anywhere, we did it. We couldn't, because you did, you know, you get knocked off. It wasn't like the thing to do. So anyway.
By the rabbis.
Oh, and these were the Palestinians. Okay. They didn't like that. The Muslims more. I don't know if they're all Muslims, but whatever. So anyway, but the regular Jewish people didn't go out on Yom Kippur, so we had the beach all to ourselves. Well, he brought magic mushrooms. I had never done those or any stuff like that in my entire life. It was so phenomenal to be on the Mediterranean with artifacts that are just in the water, pieces of pottery, and we'd been in Zafat, and we had been in haiku, whatever it is, but all this great history that was there, and just feeling the presence of it. And they did these mushrooms in this beautiful area. I popped out of this reality and could see it all for what it was and what it is. And then when I came back, I could see, and I thought, I don't have to do this. This, I could tell I was done, because I had completed what I was there to do. And I could see the signs that it was over. And I didn't know how it was going to be over, because by now it felt like it was a prison of my own making. Because I loved the freedom to travel and to be just a regular person that nobody knew, in a sense. And, you know, traveling, like, Reuben took me to this cool swimming pool that was, I think it was kind of by Jericho somewhere, but he knew all these places. And it was where some of the Israeli army people would go, but it was in the jungle. Passed by a woman who was grinding her own wheat for her, you know, her chapatis, but they're also what every woman does in every culture, making flatbread or just being in the really tasty stuff, not five-star hotels where nobody ever talks to each other, but, you know, being with folks. It was, and the cultures, and I loved it. So anyway, and swimming in this pool that somehow was and it just, everything was like, I just loved it. And when I came back, I could see also the falseness. I could see everything. And one day, it was a couple weeks before Easter of 1985. I was sitting in my chair like this, getting ready to get up to do my talk, my Sunday talk. And by now we have moved a number of different places, and we were in this Speckles Theater in downtown San Diego. I had trained many ministers. I had 24-hour prayer service. I had 5 teaching centers all over California where big screen TVs, I would do the talk, the facilitators would do the processes. I was on the covers of magazines, on TV, even jokes. Johnny Carson was doing Terry Cole-Whittaker jokes, you know. It was a whole, everything was happening, you know, all that kind of stuff. The assistant minister is talking to the congregation and saying, next week we're going to be taping the TV show. And so, and now here's Reverend Terry Cole-Whittaker. So I got up and my first, and I was sitting in the chair. The same voice from the sky, same person. So I think, I don't know if I've been chipped. I don't know who did this, what it is, said, and nobody's around, write to me, you're not doing this anymore. And I said, okay. And I knew. I got up and I said, 2 weeks from today is my last Sunday. That's it. And then when I left, I didn't know where I was going to go or what was going to happen. And there was a debt, like about $400,000, because we were 2 to 3 months behind in paying bills, which usually business, a lot of businesses do. So when you stop the train, all the cars go bam, bam, bam. And so San Diego tried to make a scandal out of it. There was no scandal. Not that I know of, but I didn't know everything, you know, was going on. But it seemed to be fine. But it was just paying those bills. And a lot of people, that we never went bankrupt. People settled. Stuff happened. Paid so much on the dollar. But it took a couple of years. And then what I did is then I went to Maui and rented a retreat center and got really back into nature. Because when I began to look at where was I really happy, where was I blissful, barefooted. I'm now my new recreating myself, because I've been Terry Cole-Whittaker, but I'm barefoot grandma now, a wise old lady. And I'm actually only 3 and a half, but my body's 75, so, you know. And I'm spiritually mature, but since there is no age, pick the age you like. And I find that 3 and a half year old people are really cool. They're smart, brilliant, present, know what's happening, just still full of vitality, just beautiful. And some of my best friends are, you know, about 4 years old, and they come over here and they're alpha. I just do what they tell me. Because, and they, I tell some little kids, they'll say, well, I say, how old are you? He said, well, I'm 4. I said, oh, really? He said, I'm 3 and a half. And they look at me like, we're, but I'm big for my age. They say, okay, they can get it. I'm just big for my age. And now they treat me like I'm one of them. It's like, I'm really into, even like the cat as a character and all people and getting to know, you know, it's just a whole, it used to be I was obsessed with myself. I told my girls one time, what was it like having narcissists for both your mother and father? They said, it was tough. But my children gave me a second chance to be a mother. Yeah, that whole thing of hearing that voice, but it was 2 times the same voice, but outside, and probably it was from within, but it wasn't my voice. And there was nobody around or anything in, like, and it was the same voice. And the way they said it, first is that's what you're, where you're going. And then I had all the symptoms of knowing that you can't make up and you can't make happen. It was any kind of, I've had many supernatural experiences. But usually they don't repeat. But this voice from the sky, it repeated by saying, you're not doing this anymore. But it was the same man's voice, but not of any man's voice that I knew or knew of. And he spoke like with authority, you're not doing this anymore. I went, okay, because I had all the knowing, same chills, same knowing, and I didn't know where I was going or what was going to happen. And so that actually began my journey of finding what was missing. Because by then, as I had said in the ministry, with all of this teaching, metaphysical teaching, fundamental teachings of Jesus, which ultimately is the Christ consciousness. It's not about a person in a sense, and it is because we're persons, but the Christ consciousness is about our own realization of who we really are. and to be only basically stuck in the left brain, adding, you know, numbers, calculations, blah, blah, war, violence, because I don't believe human beings are naturally warlike. I don't think that at all. Because we're now, if you even look at a mother kitty loving her baby or a mother puppy or, you know, any kind of mothering, and mothering is so important, we can see also going on in the world the destruction of the feminine mother and it the masculization of the female, and even people who run for political office who are supposed to be female are devoid of these qualities that are sweet and kind, but also women are intelligent and able and all this. So anyway, and I found that in the Vedas, when I began to be searching, where is this missing thing? And so the first thing before I actually really got into more studies was basically just going back in nature. Because when I started to look at where have I really been happy, this is before I began actually studying more and going away from the fundamental, more rigid teaching that I had been in, but to be really open to find knowledge and truth from wherever I could find it, and being open about that, is that sense of where was I happy, and it was always in nature. Walking barefooted with the fine dust coming up between my toes, lying on the grass, looking at the clouds and listening to the sounds. And as a little girl, I was like little Heidi, because I lived with my great-grandmother in the Sierras, and I would run and with the deer, and I would drink out of the streams, and I was like this little free child, and horses, I could ride horses and hike, and you know, and I loved that, and I longed for that again, because that was real happiness, not just the fake. So then I went to Maui and had retreats there, and that was great, and did a lot of swimming, be back in nature. And then I really couldn't do much work. And one of my books I wrote was called The Inner Path, From Where You Are to Where You Want to Be. And Neil Donald Walsh, who wrote Conversations with God, he was on my staff in the ministry. And he was a wonderful writer. And he helped write for our newsletter. And he directed some of our plays, like Godspell and all of this. I married him to two people, different people. And he was a terrific person. So anyway, I hired him to come to Maui to basically write that book for me that I spoke on audio tape. So Neil Donald Walsh really wrote that book, The Inner Path, From Where You Are to Where You Want to Be. And now we know he's a wonderful writer and spiritual teacher and doing all these good things. And he lives right in above me, not too far, about an hour and a half, up in Ashland, Oregon, and I'm here in Mount Shasta. So he's just cool. A lot of all my students, so met Tony Robbins, Marianne Williamson, Louise Hay. Well, yeah, John Rogers. Well, I knew about John Rogers. And we started showing up at some of the same events where we were talking and speaking together. And I just would hear about him from people who just loved him so much, and they were following his path. And he was very eclectic. So he would draw, like I am too, from many sources, because you got to have an open mind. And the problem is, some people, they get a teaching and they set up camp on that teaching and they never go beyond it. And so they cheat themselves out of, because it becomes a business. And it becomes a business, they have to have a brand. And then you have the brand and the business, and then you got to lock it down and you don't want to hear anything else. Now you're competing with everybody else. John Rogers was never like that. And he was, and he was very supportive of other people. So the last time I had seen John Rogers was Gavin McLeod was giving me a big Hollywood party. And this was in 1985. And so Aaron Spelling was there, and his wife. His wife had the most jewels on Candy Spelling of anybody. She had emeralds bigger than the Sultan of Brunei's his son's new bride, if you saw those pictures. Like quail eggs, these, and you, pure, clear, flawless emeralds, this Candy. She had decked out, she was. But you had all, you know, Phyllis Diller was there. Oh my gosh, Linda Gray, Linda Evans, all these actors, all the really terrific people came to this party. Well, anyway, I had invited Ariana Stephanopoulos, who's now Ariana Huffington, she was a friend, not, kind of an acquaintance, if she wanted to come to the party because I've been talking to her on the phone. So she brought John Roger with her and five of his people, and I said, oh, that's fine. And so he was wonderful and, you know, met people there, and he is his, because she was one of his students at the time. I don't know if she still does, but whatever. But anyway, she loved him, and that was great. So it's the last time, but I kept hearing about John Rogers. One time up in Washington, when I had a retreat center there, I was facing the window and the deck, and my daughter and son-in-law, they were sitting on the floor with their backs against the sofa looking at me, but their back was towards the deck. All of a sudden, there is a golden ball hovering, an orb, but it was clear, solid, and then went, it was gone. Whoa, what was that? You know, an orb. And I've had pictures, people take pictures of me with orbs, but this one was a golden orb that was there. It was amazing. So there've been lots of experiences, but you know, those also you don't want to get caught up in. And just like in some people, they go the path of mystic powers, but they happen. Like one time I was in Tulum in at Chichen Itza, well, not in Chichen Itza, but in Tulum, which is in the Yucatan. And I was at a temple. We had was a couple of friends. Cancun, yeah, a little bit south of that, and I had friends that had a retreat center there, that had been Rajneesh people, and then they had this really great, you know, beach place and all that. So anyway, we went to this goddess temple, and Mayan temples are very steep like this. In fact, I think in Chichen Itza they don't allow people to go up any longer on the temple because people fall off and die. They leave their bodies. It's steep like this, and the steps are little like this. I'm at the top, and as I start walking down, there's a couple that's with our group that they thought they were all that, you know. And I had attitude, like, well, they think they're so. I start skipping down these stairs. I have a problem sometimes. I get showing off, you know. So I trip, and I am going head first. And I went, no, and I pulled myself, you know, when you fall, your butt, boom, you're down. It's fast. But instantly I said, no, and I went up. I'm now in a bubble of slow motion in another dimension. And I am moving my whole body and my arms slowly in this time warp. And I'm able to bring my right foot down on the next step. And I now my foot hurts, obviously. And when I get down to the bottom of this temple, I'm thinking, how am I going to get to the car, which is 2 miles away, and a guy pulls up with a bicycle with a back seat. So all these journeys, you know, everybody's got their journey, which is wonderful. And my journey has been a spiritual path because I realize that's where the power is, the love is, the creativity. It's all coming for us because we're not these bodies or these minds. We have a body, we have a mind, but we have a spiritual body and a spiritual mind. And so my travels then took me to India. And first it came from a friend. He was named Daniel Maziarz. He's a wonderful friend and good teacher. And he started reading to me the Bhagavad Gita. And he read to me the Chaitanya Charitamrita and the Srimad Bhagavatamrita. And I loved it. It was like food for my soul. It told me who I am. You know, it resonated in me, how everything operates. It was so nourishing to me, and they're basically the personalness of God, that it's not just an impersonal power that you can use, but we're persons, then there's the personalness of God. And it focused on the female and the male, that the divine feminine, the divine mother, as well as the divine father, and it taught, it's ancient wisdom. It's been infiltrated, because most religions have been infiltrated by kind of a male-dominated psychopath kind of a thing, so many of them. But you have to be able to discern and not throw out the baby with the bathwater. You have to be able to, like a bee goes from flower to flower, and you get the honey, you get the pollen, but you know, you don't have to take the whole deal. And as you learn, so for me, learning to discern, to know the difference between truth or false, and it brought me to being able to move, not seeking some outside savior or somebody outside me who's going to, they can be teachers for us, but we have to fly our own ship, our own plane. That they give us the lessons, but we have to do the lessons ourselves, because they did, but they don't, can't just give it to us. We have to work at it, and we have to do it ourselves. So it gave me, and then with this interest in it, I became, it was really my path. That was, it was, I would call it advanced spirituality. And luckily there are books that are in Sanskrit that are translated into English. And then in 1999, I'd been praying for a teacher, and I was given an audio tape. And as I listened to that, and it wasn't my teacher, my guru, but it was one of his students, and he was talking, it resonated again. And I've always been, I've known to trust your inner guidance. I'm doing it more and more all the time, but even then, but a lot of times I didn't trust my inner guidance. That's when I get into trouble, because the inner guidance would say no, or do, but I wouldn't follow it, because I'd say, oh, well, that, what does that matter? But that's our guide. That's our support. So I then, in 1999, went to India, and I met my teacher. And one of the things that how I had even, I wrote about that in my book called Dare to Be Great. It was first called Every Saint Has a Past, Every Sinner a Future. But there were a lot of metaphysical churches that didn't like the word sinner, so we changed it to Dare to Be Great. And what is greatness? It's to be who you really are, to be beautiful, be you to the full. And that's all we really have to do. But most of us, we're schizophrenic, and we've got an identity crisis between who we are and who we think we should be, and everybody else wants us to be, and what the world wants us to be, and keeping us so busy and fear and everything else, we have no time to meditate, find out who we are, and follow that path, because there's so much pressure to be like everybody else, to fit, you know, to get, it's the human race. But I gave up the human race. There is no race. There's no competition. We don't have to hurry it up and get there and do it and be there. You know, I'd already done that, and I found that wasn't it. That was fine, because oftentimes you have to attain everything you want to find out that that wasn't it, but you needed to do that, and it was wonderful. And also, it's even, you know, then you leave it and you go on. So anyway, I got initiated by Hari, His Divine Holiness Shri Haridas Shastri Maharaj Babaji, who is a brilliant scholar, written over 85 books, translations from Sanskrit, brilliant, kind, wonderful, kind of looks like Heidi's grandfather. And you would never know he was Indian, because he's just, you never know, because he's beyond all that. And he passed, went on to the spiritual world in 2013, I think. So anyway, yeah, 2013. So anyway, I just couldn't eat up that knowledge at enough. I couldn't get enough of it. So I read and I studied and I read everything I could. And it really validated the teachings I liked of the Bible that were metaphysical, that were, in a sense, we would call it the Christ consciousness, but that means to be who we, to be beautiful and powerful in all that we are, but knowing we're not the big deal, we are part of that. And as part of that, we have those qualities. And it talked about we have 50 qualities that are the same as God, but in minute quantity. And also it honored the feminine and the divine goddess and the divine mother and all of the things that we had been, as a female, been so invalidated for and not acknowledging, and how important it is for men to acknowledge their feminine and for a female to acknowledge their masculine, but to have that totality of who we are, not just partiality, and also to operate and use that right brain. And I had always, what I had done is weakened my left arm, which was my right brain, and I beat up my right side, which is the left brain masculine. So I used to beat up the masculine and be weak in the feminine. So I've had to work at that to bring balance. And it's the balance, which is that Christ. So anyway, studying with him and then coming back here and teaching and trying to bring to that metaphysical spiritual community a deeper understanding than basically, say, The Secret. So The Secret has a great teaching in a sense, because it gives people the idea that they have something to do with what's going on by their thoughts. And it was going to an audience that maybe never thought about this. And of course, most of that stuff's for material stuff. It's the dog and pony show, you might say. It's what got me started. I actually started going to church more often because I wanted to read my name in the church newsletter. So, you know, so you got a bloated ego, but if it's working for you, it gets you going and all that. And one of the things that I noticed as I was doing, because I'm a researcher, I realize I'm an avid researcher. I have an open mind. I love to learn. But I also know you have to know the difference between discernment, truth and false, which you do know by your inner guidance. And a lot of people, that was one of the problems with the Vedas. They say you can't trust yourself. You just trust the scripture. But that's very masculine, where the feminine is, we do trust ourselves. And it is there and is in the teaching, but you have to search for it. But I then saw the similarities in the teachings of Jesus, of the New Testament and such, of the parts that I like. I didn't like Paul. I never liked his stuff. I only liked any teachings of Jesus because I thought, you know, he's with the CIA, I'm sure, in early stages. And so then I got into what I realized in all, and I studied all different religions and paths because I'm interested. And especially when people say, don't study that, I want to study it right away. Because why can't I study that? Why can't I learn? I can make my own choices. So I got into every teaching. Their highest teaching was the holy names of God, the sounds, the sound vibration. And all of them, because of that sound vibration and that the holy names of God. And I started to look at that and how people who were going to a fundamentalist church got really high by singing Jesus, you know, because they get into, they didn't maybe have the philosophy, but they definitely could get into this high transcendental state, and how it was always these sounds. And then now what I realize also with sounds is that even thought and words, that we generate electricity, we generate energy, and we have been used by, in a sense, you might call the control structure, where most of the thoughts we think aren't even our own thoughts. They've been programmed in there. We've been taught to think that and taught to say that and taught to believe that and taught to speak that way. Just like the language, like the word retire means get tired again. I don't retire. I'm not tired. You know, it's like spelling. English is a spell-casting language. It's called spelling. And when you spell a word, and a word, if you add an L, is world, and this is the planet, which is how we plan it, and you begin to dissect those words, those worlds that are whirled, and see how we actually do create and how it is created through us from this sound vibration, because this universe here is created by light and sound. As our consciousness is matriculating down through the dimensions and manifesting in that reality around us. So it's really important, and that's why I like to sing. And I'm actually a trained opera singer. And I was going to be an opera singer in my next life, and I thought, why wait? And I wanted to be temperamental, like Maria Callas. Why not? You know, get flowers and champagne and men falling at your feet. That sounded good for me. I thought, well, why wait?
Just do it.
I think what John Rogers says is also very much what I say, because people say, well, how have you accomplished? MGM tried to do a movie of the week of my life, but there was no way they could do it because my life has so many movies. I've done so many things. Why? Because I just did it. Most people, they don't do it because they contemplate it, they think about it, whatever. You just got to go do it. And as you begin, do the thing and the power is yours. If you don't do it, you don't have the power. And that is how it operates. So this whole thing was singing, and it says in the Vedas, the spiritual world, every word is a song, every step is a dance. It's that we really love to play. Our nature is beautiful. We're not warlike. They're wanting to blame humans for everything that goes on, but we've been tricked. We've been lied to, deceived. We've been taught to believe that we're not good enough, people will probably faint. Check out the flat earth. I mean, people say, oh, that's ridiculous. If it's ridiculous, I want to find out about it. I want to know for myself. And that's the thing. Nobody cares more about you than you do for yourself. And a really good teacher loves you. They know who you are. And they want you to be all that you can be. And they want you not just to believe them, but to find out for yourself. So how it's brought me to where I am today. I love living in nature. I love the peace and the quiet. I spend lots of my time researching and meditating. I sing. I dance. I love just being. And I really, at this time in my life, I really want people to know this, but I know most people don't want it. They've been so programmed and brain dead that they basically just accept what they've been told. So my audience are those people who are the ones who are who challenge, who question, who want to be who they really are, who are willing to do the work and are willing to be all that they can be. And even in the sense of most people believe what they believe because of movies. Anybody can put whatever they want in a movie, and people believe it. And then the movie in that Folter guy says, go to the light, go to the light. No, don't go to the light. It's a trap. You have your own life. And anybody outside of you is your light. No, they're only there to guide us to our own. And when they guide us to our own, a master is known by how many masters they make. And the real masters, the people that they teach, become all that they can be. And those that are not, they're the ones that hold it all for themselves. And they never really empower other people. So the greatest teachers, like JR, all of the great teachers that we have found, they give it all away. They want you to have it. Yes.